This is an introduction to the friendly interactive shell, also known as fish. I prepared this presentation for an event called DevTricks, and basically that event is a knowledge sharing event. Short introduction to the fish shell, which I've been using for about a month, so I'm still learning new stuff about it. So give a man a fish and you feed him for a day, teach a man a fish and you feed him for a lifetime. So hopefully I'm gonna teach some of you how to fish. It's a Unix shell. It focuses on interactive use, discoverability, and user friendliness. It was released in 2005 by a guy who goes by the alias Lil Jenkrins, and it's now being maintained by someone who goes by the alias of Ridiculous Fish. It's hosted on GitHub. The official site is fishshell.com, and there's a very good tutorial there. Installation is pretty easy. There's binary packages available for Linux and OS X. If you're running the latest version of Ubuntu like I am, 13.04, then you'll notice that the Debian package that's on the website is for 12.04, but it still runs fine on 13.04. If you're on OS X, you can also use Homebrew to install fish, or of course you can also build from source. There's a mailing list. And there's two IRC channels. Fish on Freenode, which is the unofficial channel, and then the official channel is on OFTC. So for Freenode, the server is irc.freenode.net, and OFTC is irc.oftc.net. So a bit about the design philosophy. Fish has three high-level goals. First one is that everything that can be done in other shell languages should be possible to do in Fish, though fish may rely on external commands in doing so. Second is that fish should be user-friendly, but not at the expense of its expressiveness. Most trade-offs between power and ease of use can be avoided with careful design. And third, whenever possible, without breaking the above goals, fish should follow the POSIX syntax. There's some specific design principles that it also follows to achieve these three high-level goals, and I'll go through these quickly. First is the law of orthogonality. The shell language should have a small set of orthogonal features. Any situation where two features are related but not identical, one of them should be removed, and the other should be made powerful and general enough to handle all common use cases of either feature. The law of responsiveness. The shell should attempt to remain responsive to the user at all times, even in the face of contended or unresponsive file systems. It is only acceptable to block in response to a user-initiated action, such as running a command. Configurability is the root of all evil. Every configuration option in a program is a place where the program is too stupid to figure out for itself what the user really wants, and should be considered a failure of both the program and the programmer who implemented it. Now, there is a lot that you can configure in Fish, but this design principle basically says, out of the box, you shouldn't have to configure stuff if you don't want to. The law of user focus. When designing a program, one should first think about how to make an intuitive and powerful program. Implementation issues should only be considered once a user interface has been designed. The law of discoverability. A program should be designed to make its features as easy as possible to discover for the user. And these main features are listed on the official website. Auto-suggestions, sane scripting, man page completions, glorious VGA color, web-based configuration, and it just works out of the box. And I'll go over a few of these in no particular order. Fish natively supports Term 256, a state-of-the-art in terminal technology. You'll have an astonishing 256 colors available for use. Alright, so if you use Fish, everyone's gonna see all these fancy colors in your terminal and you'll be like this cool guy putting on sunglasses. Aw yeah. Auto-suggestions, syntax highlighting, tab completions. Fish suggests commands as you type, based on history and completions, just like a web browser. Syntax highlighting has meaning, it's not just there to make the shell look prettier. Whenever a command is red, that means it's invalid. Blue means it's valid, and gray means there's a suggestion. Arguments that are valid file paths are also underlined. So I'll type in something that doesn't make sense, it's not a valid command, and now you can see that it's red. If I type something that does exist though, here, grep, that's a valid command, so it's blue, and now you can see there's an auto-suggestion based on history, because in the past I did a grep for, 3.8, and 4.6 wildcard, and so now it auto suggests that. So this file path is underlined, which means it's a valid file path. The colors and many other options can all be changed if you don't like them, but I find the ones that are default are good enough. Fish knows about options thanks to man page completions. So for example, here's an option that it knows, some other options that it knows. So you can autocomplete options, which is pretty cool. The command to do that is fish update completions. Complete the auto suggestion by hitting the right arrow key. For example, here's a suggestion. Now I can hit the right key and that auto completes it. Tab completions. So if you press tab and fish will attempt to complete the command, argument, or path. So I'm going to hit tab now. And here's a bunch of suggestions. If there's more than one possibility, it lists them. Right, so it didn't autocomplete yet because there's many more possibilities. If I hit tab again, it'll cycle through the possibilities. Fish can complete many commands like git branches. So I'll show an example. First I'll do it in bash. Right, so I have two branches in this git repository. If I hit tab, it'll show a bunch of branches, but it also shows tags. And it doesn't differentiate between the two, so I don't know what's a tag and what's a branch. Now I'm going to exit out of this, and then I'll do it in fish. So now we can see what the tags are and what the branches are. And you can also see that I modified my prompt so that it shows the current branch that I'm in if I happen to be inside a Git repository. And now I can hit tab to go through the various options. Your syntax highlighting, auto suggestions, and tab completions out of the box. Wow. A bit about scripting. So it has sane scripting. Fish is fully scriptable and its syntax is simple, clean, and consistent. Here's an example function that I wrote earlier that takes a tar or tarball and then tries to untar it. So every function begins with function and everything also has a end tag. Well, not everything, but anything that has opens up a code block. You can see here there's a description option, which is optional. Here I'm setting a local variable, and a local variable doesn't interfere with any other variables of the same name. And what I'm doing is I'm grabbing the extension, the last part of the extension, in case there's multiple dots. Then I'm doing a switch case, so if the extension ends in tar, then I run this command with the argument that I passed it, which would be the tar file. All right, if the extension ends with gz, then I run this command. bz2, I run that command. For everything else, so this is kind of like a default, just echo unknown extension. Functions can also fire on events. So this function foo will fire on the event bar. This is just a made-up event. Then it echoes something. If you type in the command functions, then it lists all the functions that you have, including aliases, because aliases don't really exist in fish. Aliases are really just functions. So it'll show all your functions and aliases, and I cut it off because there's so many. If you want to see a specific function, then you can just write function ls, and it'll show you the code. You can also just go to where the actual function is located, which is in home, and it's in a hidden folder .config/fish/functions. So for example, you can have a function called fish prompt, which you will have because that's your prompt. And all functions, function files have to end in .fish. The equivalent of the bash rc file is fish.config, and that's in home/.config/fish/config.fish. So here's a bit of cool stuff that I like. There's a recursive wildcard which searches directories recursively. And here's how I use it in one of my aliases. In my music folder, I have music at the top level, and I also have music in subdirectories, so for example for different albums. Now with this alias, if I just type play music, it'll run mplayer, shuffle all the music files. Really quiet, I don't want to see any junk in my output. And it plays all the music, doesn't matter if it's in a subdirectory or at the top level of my music folder. It just plays it all. Alt and up, instead of exclamation and dollar sign to get the last part of the previous command. So for example, say you just made a directory with a very long and complicated name. You know, you can just hit type CD and then Alt and up, and then there it is, and I can even demonstrate this. Alright, so I'll just say touch file1.txt, file2.txt. So say I created two files. I just want to open the last one, file2.txt. Now if I hit Alt and up, there we go. Alt left and Alt right, you can use that to navigate directory history if the prompt is empty. So for example, if you're in home and then I CD into desktop slash stuff, and now I hit Alt left to go back in history, and I print the working directory, now I'm all of a sudden back in home. This works similar to push D and pop D, if you're familiar with those commands, which are commands to push directories on the stack and pop them off the stack. It makes for easier navigating, but this is built into Fish. So here I'll go into a folder, and now I hit Alt left. I'm now in Home Dennis. If I hit Alt right, now I'm in the folder I was previously in. If the prompt is not empty, then Alt left and Alt right jumps over words for quick editing, and I don't think this is possible in Bash as far as I know. Correct me if I'm wrong. Alright, say I type something, now I can easily go over the words quickly. I don't think this is possible in Bash, for example. Alright, Alt left, Alt right, it produces that output. If I do Control left, Control right, that doesn't work either. So I don't know if this is possible in Bash, I don't think it is. There's also web-based configuration, so if you're lucky enough to have a graphical computer, you can set your colors and view functions, variables, and history all from a web page. All you have to do is run the command fish config, and I can demonstrate that. Alright, so here we see, this is the web configuration for fish. Default page, or the landing page, is where you can change all the colors for whatever you want. So I can change colors for text, I can change the color for background. I've never changed the color for anything because I find the colors that it ships with are good enough. You can also change your prompt, and it actually shows you how the prompt would look like before you change to it. And it also shows you the code for the prompt. And these are all prompts that Fish ships with by default. So I'll just go through a few of these so that you can see how they look like. You'll notice that some prompts might shorten the current directory that you're in. Some prompts might show the current working branch, if it's a Git repository. This one even shows the time. Of course, the more stuff you put inside your prompts, the slower Fish will become. For example, right now because I'm in a Git repository, it has to see what the current branch is. So you can see when I hit enter, it's not super responsive, it's not instant. If I go to something that's not a Git repository, it's a bit quicker. So I'll show you a bit of the other prompts. Oh, that one's cool. It even has a lightning bolt in it. And you can also see all the functions that you have. So it lists them all on the left, and you can see the code on the right. Most of these are functions that I added. For example, this one adds the GPL, GNU public license, to any directory that you're in. And if you want to see more of my custom functions, go to my .files repository on GitHub. You can also see all the environment variables, or just variables that Fish currently has set. And you can also see your command line history. So there's a few ways how to get help. If you just type help, then it shows general help in a browser. I'll show you what that looks like. Alright, so this is the general help. You can also get specific help for that command. So for example, you can type help function or man function if you want to open it in a man page. I'll just open it in a man page because I don't want to open it in the browser right now. Now here you can see the man page. The content from the man pages and from the browser help is the same. And of course you can also get help on IRC, Stack Overflow, and the docs, which is our website. A few gotchas and tips. So fish is purposely limits the number of built-ins, which are commands that fish includes by default, and it does this to maintain simplicity. For example, bash has built-in string manipulation. If I set the string file.txt to a variable called x, and I just want to get the file part, so anything before the dot, so basically I don't want the extension, then I can do this complicated thing, and it gives me whatever's before the dot. Fish doesn't have anything like this built in, so you'll have to use another utility that spawns a new process. For example, here I use base name on the x variable, and then I just remove dot text. You can also use sit or whatever else you want to. AWK does matter. Fish is not POSIX compliant. Although this is considered an advantage by many, not a disadvantage, because there's less legacy baggage to carry around. And you don't run into compliance-related issues very often. When you do, you quickly kind of work around them. Vim assumes that your shell is sh compatible. You should add the line set shell is sh to your Vim RC if you use Vim. If you use virtual environment or virtual environment wrapper, some people say that it doesn't work very well with fish out of the box. I don't know, I've never tried it, but someone went and made a project called Virtual Fish, so you can try that out. You can easily run bash scripts in fish. For example, you can just run a script with the command bash, or you can add a shebang line at the top of your scripts, which you should be doing anyway. Or you can just run bash, so you would just type bash, then do whatever you have to do, and then exit out when done. All variables in fish are really lists. Which is cool because then you can iterate through them in a for loop. For example, even your path is a list, so you can iterate through your path and, for example, show all the directories that are in your path. You access in elements with bracket notation, just like if it were an array. And you can also do slicing, so you can get ranges of elements in the list. And if you try to access the element at -1, then that's the last element in the list. If you're a fan of Oh My Z Shell, which is kind of a community-built dot files, then you can check out Oh My Fish. Personally, I don't recommend these projects because they add a bunch of clutter to your shell that you probably won't be using, and it'll just slow it down. Anyway, that's it. Fish is fast, the auto-completion is amazingly helpful, and it's intuitive to use without too much configuration. So give it a try. Thanks for watching.